moment and think about the women in your life. Think about your mother, your sister, your grandmother, your cousin, your daughter, or your wife. Each one of these women could be victims of gender-based violence or femicide.
Tsegofatse Pule was killed while carrying her 8-month-old baby. Karapo Mokoena was burnt by her boyfriend. And Kirsten Klutz, who never returned home from her morning run. These names might sound very familiar to you, but there are almost 300 women in our country who are killed every month, whose names you might not ever know.
We have heard it before that South Africa is notoriously known as a rape capital of the world. And as agitating as this may sound, our crime statistics only confirm this pandemic. Every 14 seconds, a woman or a child is a victim of violence. Every 3 hours, a woman is killed. And over 110 women are raped every single day in our nation.
The time is now, South Africa. Join us as we take our country back. Through our CRC Beautiful Ashes campaign, we are joining hands with our community to care for victims of gender-based violence and enforce preventative methods to curb this disease in our country.
We are going to play our part to restore the dignity of these women and children of GBV by handing over 10,000 care crates of essential items in police stations, schools, clinics, and rural communities. We will also educate and minister to these women and children. As we know, education can play a key part to prevention and the successful conviction of perpetrators.
Be part of the solution with us and use what is in your hands to make a difference through our Beauty for Ashes campaign. You can either contribute financially using the details below towards the items that go into our care crates, or you can drop off the items that go into the crate at our church premises. You can also sign up to join our teams as we head out into the communities. All the details that you need can be found on our website, crcchurch.com.
We are conquering this mountain one step at a time. We cannot give up. We cannot back down. We cannot step aside and allow everyone else to do it for us. From Luke 4 and Isaiah 61, we know that the Spirit of the Lord is upon us because He has anointed us to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent us to heal the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty to the captives, to comfort all who mourn, to give beautiful ashes, the oil of joyful mourning, and the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness.
Join hands with us today as we change the world, one woman at a time.
To another Sunday. It is now time for praise and worship. Come and let's join the band in lifting up the name of Jesus.
Morning, church. Come on, let's lift the name of Jesus high in Jesus' name. I wish I could tell you, wish I could describe it, but I can't contain it, can't keep it to myself. There aren't enough colors to paint the whole picture. There aren't enough words to every say what I found.
Wonderful and beautiful and glorious and holy, He is merciful and powerful.
Who are we talking about? That's my King. Who we talking about? That's my King. There's the one before you. Yes, we will adore you. All of this is for you. Who we talking about? That's my King.
Oh, I'm not letting the rocks cry without joining the chorus. They aren't enough notes to make the harmony. It's the song of the ages. It's the song of the angels. With all of the earth we make a symphony. Wonderful and beautiful and glorious and holy is merciful and powerful.
Who are you talking about? That's my King.
We declare the glory, give him all the honor, altogether worthy.
Who are you talking about? That's my King.
There's the one before you. Yes, we will adore you. All of this is for you.
Who we talking about? That's my King.
Hey, that's my King, Jesus. That's my King. That's my God. That's my Shepherd, my Protector. That's my King. That's my Rock. That's my Anchor. My Defender. That's my King. That's my God. That's my Shepherd, my Protector. That's my King. That's my Rock. That's my Anchor. My Defender.
Who are you talking about?
That's my King.
Yeah.
We declare the glory. Altogether worthy.
Who we talking about?
That's my King. We declare the glory. Give him all the honor. Altogether worthy.
Who we talking about?
That's my King.
There's the one before you.
Yes, we will adore you.
All of this is for you.
Who we talking about?
That's my King.
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 Jesus.
We believe in you, our Father, our King, our Lord. And this morning he is with us. Two or three gather in his name, he shall be present amongst us. And so we worship him together. We call him forever Yahweh, the Lord God Almighty.
Yeah. of the glory.
And say, you are worthy. You are worthy of our world, of our opinions, of our thoughts. You are worthy of our time. You are worthy of our talents, of our treasure. You are worthy. And we thank you this morning that every word that we speak will be to glorify you, to lift your name. Whatever we do this morning is to glorify you and to lift your name. Our children, we are dedicating this morning that they will glorify you, the parents, as they present their children and say, Father, here is your children. In Jesus' name, Father, we pray that everyone listening, everyone sitting here, will have a touch from you, your love and peace that surpasses all understanding. will be upon this house right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, if you believe that, give God a big shout of praise. What do we believe? That God gets the glory. Not me, not my opinion, but God gets all the glory. Come on, give Him a shout of praise. Right there on YouTube Live, we want to welcome you. And right here in this house, we want to welcome you. If it's your first time here, really, really welcome. Come on, family. Together. It seems like half of the church is on holiday. That's all right. We are here. That's the most important thing. And I was thinking about this this morning. Driving to church is the best thinking time that I ever have. Always. That's just my thinking times. And God showed me that as people go on holiday, how they secure their houses. If you secure your house, you make sure that everything is locked. There's people watching your house, and you make sure all the windows are closed. And if you stay in Mpumalanga, you know that you don't just close it for the thieves, you close it for the snakes and all those other bad stuff that get into the house. For me, a snake is a bad thing. In the Bible says I can crush his head. I don't relax. But I'm just saying, because they don't cross my path yet. I'm just saying. And then God showed me, how protective are you about my house? And how protective are you about my anointing? Do you close all the doors? Do you close places where the enemy can come in? Like we have an open spot here, and we have an open spot here, and we have an open spot there, and we have an open spot there, and we have an open spot there. And it comes down to, will I step in? Will I go above my reasoning and explanation and my thought to step in? This is a war. And I don't want Satan to come and kill and steal and destroy what we have built. I'm talking of how we should think. If there's someone in urgent need, we run to the person and say, hey, can I help you? If you see there's an accident, you run to those people, can I help you? And when we get into the kingdom of God, you see, there's a spot. I cannot allow Satan to take over the spot, so I will come and stand here, and I will play, and I will sing, and I will do whatever I have to do, because we have to secure the house. We have to secure, because... You see, this whole year we've talked about following Jesus. And we're talking about living for Jesus. And it comes down to, I have to do my part. We've seen that we can do nothing without Jesus. Yes? Say amen. Okay? And then we've seen that Jesus have done nothing without the Holy Spirit. And then when he went to heaven, he said, I will ask the Father to give you this gift, the Holy Spirit. Now, we can do nothing without Jesus, and we can do nothing without the Holy Spirit. Yes? Okay, say amen. Amen, sex them song. Okay, dank je toch. And now the third thing, God gave the earth to the human beings to have dominion. To take over, to be fruitful, to multiply. So without then Jesus and without the Holy Spirit, nothing is happening. Then without you and me doing our part in the house and in the kingdom of God, nothing will happen. You are as important. No, you were never as important as God. But we are important to God so that the work will be done. And when we see there's an empty space, not to sit around and say, it's another person's job. It's another person to get that one saved, to invite that one, to play the guitar or the guitar or the whatever. If there's an open space, I take responsibility, God. I take responsibility. I don't want to see an open window in your house. I don't want to see an open window in the place. I don't care how angry you are. Get over it. It's for God. It's for His kingdom. It's to be heavenly minded, to be kingdom minded. Walk into this house and say, yeah, but we sang a song and we said, for your glory, for your glory, for your glory, for your glory, I will lift my hands out of my own stench and get it up above in the heavens so that I can connect. Like a child come to God this morning, raise these hands or her hands and say, Father, here I am, like a little child running to their father and greet them when he comes from home. like we should be like that on a Sunday when we get here. Be excited about Jesus. Be excited about who He is, because He's excited like that when He sees us. He's excited like that when we run to Him. He runs to you. He runs to you in your greatest distress. He runs to you in your greatest need. He is the one running to you. As you turn to Him, He says, I'm there. I will be with you. And so we respond back. And that's what the Bible says. We love God because He has first loved us. Amen. So may we love Him so much that we protect His house. May we love Him so much that we do what He asks us to do. May we love Him so much that we love other people, that we love our neighbors, that we love God and the things of God and the people of God more than anything else in this world, in Jesus' name. Why? Because we are important to Him to get the job done. Jesus has said, I've done my business. I've done the business till the end. Now I'm going. Now you do the business, the kingdom business, till I come back. And if that is you and you believe that that morning, jump into your place and space and start doing what God is expecting of you in Jesus' name. Come on, let's give Him a big praise this morning. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm glad you are here. On that note, you can go home now. We're going to have baby dedication. That was the sermon. That was it. That was the sermon. A greater exchange have to happen. Nee, jong, ek surf nou nie vandag nie, want ek vat nou af. Ja, en as daar nou 'n gat oop is, nou wat nou? Is nou right dat die duivel aan klim. There's no one selling coffee outside. Okay, we don't get saved by coffee in any case. Or maybe some of us do get, if you don't get the first coffee in the morning, you are not saved. You have to get that first coffee. We're all like that. 4 this morning when I wake up, I go make a coffee before I prepare. So that's what we do. But I'm asking, can we get over ourselves and get back into the place where we should be and get into the places where we should serve and make sure that everything is protected and everything is working? Why? Because we want the kingdom of God to accelerate. We want the kingdom because we represent not Hennie van der Merwe here. We're not representing CRC here. We represent Jesus Christ, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, our Lord, our King, in Jesus' name. Come on, if you believe that, give Him a praise. And now the second thing which I want to talk about, the greater exchange. So that was your mind. That was your opinion. Your anger. Né? Jou vrou vat nie jou nonsense jy by die huis kom. En jy so dikbek nie, nê? So, the same year. Nou is jy dikbek, nou moet Jesus jou gebruik. Nee, sies. Raak beter. En surf, doen jou werk. Like we have to do. God place people in the body, the members in the body, for what they should do and where they should serve. Yes. For the edifying. He gave gifts to the church, Ephesians 4. He gave gifts to the church. We make this church thing too difficult. The gifts of the church, pastor, apostle, pastor, evangelist, teacher. I always forget the other one. Prophet. These 5 offices, not to be important, but they're to equip the saints for the work of ministry. So we all work ministry. We all have a calling. We all have a job to do in the kingdom of God. And if we don't do that job, not just here, but outside in the world, nothing will happen. If we don't go out and see people saved, nothing will happen. If we don't love people out there and love one another, then how will they know we're disciples of God? So it's a love, it's our serving, it's our loving just for one another, and then the world out there that needs saving. The protection of the anointing. What is the anointing? The working of God. Where God works. I have so much respect for the Holy Spirit this morning that I will serve and not have my own resting time. I have so much respect that I will climb my car tonight and drive to that person in need that they need to be helped. They need another Christian around them. I have so much respect for the Holy Spirit that I will have that home cell this week, even though I don't want to do that. I have so much respect for the Holy Spirit that I will go and feed the poor. I have so much respect for the Holy Spirit that we are going to build that house for Him. I have so much respect for the Holy Spirit that I will make sure that those who do not have clothes, I have so much respect. And by the way, we bring back the buses for the poor. We're going to bring them back because we have an obligation to the poor in this area. So we bring them back and we are going to install that. So I ask every one of you here to start also giving into that fund for transport ministry. It's coming back. It's coming back. That's it. Starting the new... So we go, those who cannot get to church, we're going to get them and we bring them to church. It's our obligation. It's our, it's what Jesus asked us to do. Okay. Amen. Now you can go home because now I finish with the sermon. But just sit, I just want to say a few things before we go home. Just the quick things that I have to say. We had an amazing time in Durban at the Olive Convention Center with Pastor At, seeing that revival. And the main message at the revival was, everyone wants revival, fall down. Everyone wants the touch of God, shout, and have this whole thing. And then it all boils down to one, and that is love for one another, love for God, love for one another. If we don't love one another, how will we say that we are disciples of Jesus Christ? Because it's your love for one another. It is the love of God that compels us. The love of God. We love Him because He first loved us. 1 John 4. We love Him because He first loved us. That's it. He loved us first. How do you know that? Okay, let me ask you. We have so many opinions about Christ and how the Bible should be and church should be and we are so full of it. That we're not willing to listen to what he's actually saying. And that's maybe why he wrote, and many people are against church. Why did Jesus then report on the church as John in Revelation? Oh, yeah, the book is becoming like, it's a little bit difficult. I don't read that book. Yes, and that's why you are so full of yourself and not believing in the church. Because he's talking to the seven churches. And then at the end of every one of those sentences, he says, those who have ears should listen. And we listen, but we listen with what ears? Our feeling ears? Our emotional ears? Our what can I get out of this ears? We have one job to do. It was so clear. We have baby dedication this morning. Parent, it's your responsibility to keep that child in the house of God. To raise them up in the house of God. Next week you get offended, now you take the child out of the house of God. That ain't Jesus. That ain't the Holy Spirit. He never told you to leave. You left. Now you cut off your children's future from them. Right there. It's your responsibility to keep the child in the house. And in, but now the child keeps you out of the house. Who's the boss now? Near Akazipa, near Lake Manisuni. Because Yanni is telling you not to come to church on a Sunday. Why? It's difficult. When he asked my brother, difficult thing. My daughter was a baby, 1 year old. Then I put her on my lap and I take her to church. And he kind of het nie nodig gehad om in die kerk rond te hardloop nie. Sit still. Nee, maar alles maar moeilik. Not this one. This one will sit still. I'm the dad. And when she's in church, there's no cell phone playing with a cell phone while in church. It is a service. Parents, how do you allow your children to play cell phone games in the middle of a service? You should teach them. Now you teach them disrespect towards God. You teach them it's okay to sit and play games in church. Now all of you go, sit near. Yes, that will be a good thing to do now, right now. Yamalisa, they don't sit still. Do you tell me as a parent that you have no control over that child? You're the parent. You have to go to God and ask Him how. The Holy Spirit, how? We are the ones to teach them in the way they should go. Now, what is that going way? Playing on my cell phone or a tablet through the whole service. It's not the way to go. It's the word of God. It's the worship of God. Watch these little children in church, how they worship God, how their hands goes up when they praise God. I'll show them all of them. It's going up into kids' church, being trained, because the parent makes sure that that child is trained. How? Because day one after their birth, day one, week one, that little baby was back in church, as difficult as it is. As difficult as it is. And some of you don't know me, and you say, Yo, who's are you know yet? Jy moet eers kinders kry. Hey, my dogter trou nou hierdie jaar, so moet nie eers met my verder praat nie. Let me not mention all the other things that I'm doing. So it's that, it's, we teach the children the way they should go. My daughter never had an opinion or a will or anything when we go to church. Get on my lap, let's go. As she gets difficult in church, I say, sit still. Pas by die huis kom, gaan ek en jy gesels oor die ding. Why should they sit still in their classes at school, but at church they can sit and play games on their tablets? Because it's been taught, it's okay. I don't have a go at the tablets, but I do have a go at the tablets. But it's not why what I'm preaching. I'm saying we have to be very aware how and what we let into our children's ears. We talk about the world that is bad and media that's bombarding us with a lot of things. But we allow them to play those things. Don't you think there's subliminal messages inside of those games or programs they watch? They should just at least somewhere in the week come into an environment where it's truth being spoken to them. I speak of none movie I watched. I speak of none sermon I listened. I speak of what the Holy Spirit have taught me and tell me to preach. And if it's not out of the Bible and out of the Word, because I am you, like you, programmed by a lot of messages. I am also like you and you like me, programmed by a lot of media and TikToks and whatever you watch. Yes, I am. Sometimes I say something and it jumps. Brr, and I go like, is that really in the Bible? Yeah, it is. I'm sure I saw it there. Then at least I'll go to my studies and the Bibles and the translation and go, is that true? Is it really there? I've many times prepared a sermon. I go like, yeah, this is a smart thing to say. Bam. And then the Holy Spirit checks me and says, make sure that's in my word. Just make sure. I go like, all right, let's go. Go in. Oh, there's nothing like that in the Word. It sounds so nice. Because Piet Poggenpoel said it on YouTube. We follow everyone, but you don't know who you're following. The Bible says you heap yourself of many teachers. But only have one Father in the Lord. And we miss that. We miss this thing. And your child... How many fathers does your child have? One. You. You raise that child. That child have to make one day a decision to follow Jesus. Up till that point, you stand in the gap for that child. By your faith, they are saved. Then they come to age. This is now teaching for the. I told you, I'm finishing with the sermon, so I'm just doing now the baby dedication. Then we go. So, that child is, catch you. You'd never talk about the church or an authority figure or anything in front of that child. Because you're an authority figure in front of that child. You show them respect while you talk in front of them. Not even the president. You don't do that. Not even a president of another country. Because you teach them. Authority does not exist. And I can say whatever I want. Now you get to the age of 16 and that little one has been trained to dishonor authority. So my dad had this thing. Every time he saw a traffic officer, I can't say the words here. It's a little bit spicy. But every time he sees a traffic officer, I say, daar is daai. And then he uses a swear word there. Nee? I can't say. So one day, the traffic officer stopped us. And as he looked into the window, I shouted, I said, my pa, he's the, and I used the word. And the traffic officer goes, I'm a what? I've just been trained, that is their name. Now we've got a problem. Now that was funny, and it's all these kind of things, but that's exactly. Now you get to the age of 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, and they are rebellious against you, because you taught them that authority means nothing. A no is a no. A yes is a yes. No means no. Teach them day one what is no. A no is near as near. You moan about everything and everyone. What are they going to do? Imitate you. So we have a great responsibility. Parents doing baby dedication today. Like with these children. And as you and as I do not always know exactly what to do, we have the Bible. That we have to go back to. As you and I are programmed by many things in social media, We have to go back to the Bible and do what the Bible says. That's the only middle ground we all have, and the solid ground we all have is the Bible, the Word of God. This is what we have. If a brother angers me, I have to go to the Bible. If a sister angers me, I have to go to the Bible. If I want to get away from my partner in life, then I have to read the Bible. And not read it by the way, but read the Bible in its entirety, in its total form. That means following Jesus. Now, here comes the question that I actually started off this whole long 20-minute discussion. So, as clever as we are, what day is it today? Hey? Who says it's Sunday? Wait. Tenminste, weet jy, was dit dag van die week, is dit, nee? Okay, jylle jong klomp asof daar sit in 'n ry. What day is this? You are now heavenly minded. You let wings to fly. Jesus, I love you. How do we follow Jesus? Do we know what day is it today? Palm Sunday. Huh? Okay, what's Palm Sunday? Die palms groei op Sondag. Jy plant palms op Sondag, dis wat dit beteken. And not on any other day. That's it, né? Yeah, that's it. Because they don't know what's Palm Sunday. But we follow Jesus. You can tell me everything about John 3:16. You can tell me everything about running home sales. You can tell me everything about baptizing people. You can't tell me what is Palm Sunday. But we are following Jesus. I do not have a go at you. I promise you, I don't. I'm teaching now. We call it shock teaching. Huh? And then you remember it. Because next year I'm going to ask you again, then you're going to shout. Palm Sunday is the Sunday when Jesus entered into Jerusalem, when he rode on the donkey. That teacher, you should buy new cars. Because he didn't drive on a second-hand donkey, he drove on a new donkey. I'm just playing that one, okay? Okay, I'm playing. Sorry, husbands, now I messed you up. Wife says, never again. Pastor said so. So, Palm Sunday is the Sunday before Easter. It was Easter this coming week. It's like that. I was just checking. How do you know it's Easter coming? Because you're going where? Because your holiday is booked. All right. So we understand everything, but and we follow Jesus, but we don't even know what he did a few years ago, 2,000 years ago. He rode on a donkey into a town, and then the people. They don't even know who he was. Came and run to him. And they shout, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. To the highest. And they put the palm trees and clothes in front of him as he rode in. And shouting. And the people said, stop shouting. The people are making a big noise. And he says, if I stop them now, the rock's going to cry out. The rocks will cry out. And may we be the church this morning that not let one rock cry out. Jesus this morning, but we the church that shout out Jesus because we love him and we follow him, and because we follow him, we know exactly that this whole week is about Jesus. This week he's going to the temple, and then he's going to clean out the temple and say, I'm going to break it down and raise it up again. It is this week that our King and our Master and our Lord is going to hang on a tree, like the Bible said, where he gave his whole life, when the greatest exchange have ever happened, where he gave his will and his life and his love and his care back to us. When he took the sin upon him, the greatest mark in Christian history, the greatest mark in any history, in human history, the greatest mark that everything in the universe, even your calendar, has been marked by that day when Jesus hung after Christ, before Christ. Everything changed after that date. It was the time when human beings could go into heaven. Let us make this coming Easter a big one, like I'm doing today with Palm Sunday, thinking about my King, thinking about my Master, thinking about my Savior. He's our Savior. He's our King of Kings, Lord of Lords. We should think about nothing else this week. This week running up to the Easter time, to the time when our God gave His life for us, when our God gave His blood for us. And Father, This year, I'm not doing it, but now, this coming year, I'm going to follow you, Jesus. I'm going to worship you, Jesus. My children will worship you. I'm going to give you my life in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, we should all be in church with a great anticipation and celebration. Invite your families. Bring your families. Have a great feast after Sunday's morning service and say, hey, let's celebrate what Jesus did. Eat lamb, eat something. Have the greatest time. And then in the evening we come all together and we're going to have a great time Sunday night. Friday we're going to celebrate the crucifixion of Jesus Christ when he hung on the tree. This day, this morning, we celebrate Jesus in our lives. To him all the glory. It's a great exchange. It's a great exchange. It's easy to say it like this. It's easy to say to Jesus. We've read this whole year what Jesus have done, what he've said, how he did it. And there's a lot. The last place we got to was the Samaritan woman at the well. When she was there at the well, and he says, is it well with, he's talking to her about the well, the water coming out. We read about the woman, the Shunammite woman, that said, it is well with my soul. We read about this well, the water, the Holy Spirit that comes from the inside that we have. But this great exchange is what Jesus has shown us. So the second thing after the Samaritan woman, he traveled and the disciples had a question to him and they asked him something. I'll show it now. We'll talk about it now in the Word. But I want to talk about this great exchange of an old life versus a new life. Because we, before Christ, whatever we did, whatever we do, is not working. It never worked. It is what happens after I gave my life to Jesus. How many of you have traveled overseas or traveled to another country? Okay, now all of you that went overseas or traveled to another country, or go to Mozambique or you go to Swaziland, paid with rands there. How many of you got it right to pay? Or you go there to Thailand or USA, you pay with the rands. They're under, eh? How many of you did it? None. Why not? It does not count there. It's zero. And then you give that rand for a dollar. What do you get? Nothing. All right? Almost nothing back. So our currency don't work there. You have to exchange your currency for their currency so that you can transact and eat and work and everything. Otherwise, when you walk into that kingdom, into that place, you cannot transact by your ways and your standards. You have to transact by their standards. Yes, the money. Oh, money answers all things, the Bible says. The Bible says that you cannot serve money or God. So money is a big thing, actually. But actually, the Bible calls it the least. Now you have to exchange. You give your money to them. They give you back what they think your money is worth. And you always go like, what? What's this now? And only a few countries you go that you get back more in numbers than, you know. You exchange. You are willing. Why? Why are you willing to exchange? You have to eat. You have to buy stuff. You have to live somewhere. You have to be transported somewhere. Otherwise, you just sit there right in that airport and watch planes coming up and down the whole time. A great exchange. Your first thing you run to is the exchange shop or kiosk. You exchange so that you can do business. Otherwise, you go nowhere. My question is, when you enter the kingdom of God, have you exchanged your earthly stuff for heavenly stuff? Have you exchanged your earthly life for the heavenly life so that you operate by heavenly principles? Because when you give your life to Jesus, you start operating by their principles, not by your principles and my principles anymore and the world principles, but you start operating by the principles of God when you're a Christian. That means today is very important because that is our standard. That means coming this Friday, I go to church, which is my standard. It is one of the greatest feasts that have ever been held and still up till day by the Jewish people. Easter is Easter. You don't play around. Or Passover, 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 Passover. I'm not sure how to say that. Passover. So you go to Passover weekend, that is the lamp, it means that the angel, death angel, have passed over the house, saved the house, because there was blood of the lamb on the doorpost, so it passed over. And then they celebrate because they left. It was when the firstborns in Egypt was killed. Before the Israelites moved out, a great exchange happened. When you gave your life to Jesus, have you done that great exchange yet? That love for people, that love for God, that love for His house? Or is it still your opinion and your anger and your ways, my family, my children? And it should be very important. It's one of the most important things in our lives. But it's like, they do not go over what God has done for us. They do not get preference over God. God gets the preference now. And everything aligns towards that. That's the exchange. I exchange my old life for this new life. It costs you nothing, by the way. And you will then realize that there's nothing that you could have done to get into heaven but by the blood of Jesus. His exchange is all. You have Jesus, you have the currency. You have it all. You have it all. You can enter into heaven. When you die, you go to heaven right there. Because He paid the price. Jesus paid the price on the highest level. Jesus. Everyone says Jesus. Please just say Jesus. This Christianity means nothing without Jesus. This Christianity is nothing without Jesus. And we can't follow Jesus. Who do we follow? We can't love like Jesus. How do we love? Husbands, how do you love your wife if you don't even know how Jesus loved? But you're angry with every person out there. You're angry with the government. You're angry with whites. You're angry with blacks. You're angry with this. You're angry with that. How is that following Jesus? How do we get there? You're angry with your brother. You're angry with your family. You're angry with that one. You're angry with those. And isn't it an angry ball? Why are you so angry if Jesus is your Savior? He saved you from anger. He saved you from depression. He saved you from many things. He is now what I follow. Although you make me a little bit angry, the Bible says I will not sin. And I will forgive and I will move on and I will live this life. I don't mean I'm going to do business with you, but I will be friendly with you. You steal my car once, I'm never going to borrow you my car again. That ain't happening. I'm still loving you. You have to love people. As I said, that's what we saw again. A revival turning into only love, 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 love. Not all fall down and shout and scream and go crazy, but love. Love for people. Jesus loved us so much. John 4:27-38, he says, and at this point his disciples came to him, and they marveled that they talked with a woman, yet no one said, what do you seek? Or why are you talking to her? The woman then left the water pot, went her way into the city, and said to the man, come and see a man who told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Then they went out to the city and came to him. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. But he said to them, I have food to eat of which you do not know. There it is, another standard. We don't live by the things of this world anymore. We do not live by the things of the world. We live by the word of God. Therefore, the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him anything to eat? Still, they don't even understand this. May we understand this morning. Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Wow. It's the will of God and His word, and then the work of God. And then he goes on. He says, do not say there are still 4 months, then to come comes the harvest. He says, behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes, look at the fields, for they are already white for the harvest. And he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life. He's talking about eternal life rewards. He's talking about by what we live, by the harvest. By the will of God. By doing what God sent us to do. What did He send us to do? For the harvest. He's talking about it here. He's talking about the woman at the well. He's talking about what she's just did. He says, do not say, why do you worry about the food here? worry about the harvest. Look and see the harvest. There's people that need saving. You are stuck in your opinion, and you are stuck in your own world, and your own needs, and your own this. Want Piet Pogempoel het iets gesê eendag, and you follow him now? No, follow Jesus, follow the word. He who reaps and receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life. That both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this is the saying, is true. One sows, another reaps. I send you to reap for what which you have not labored. Others have labored and you have not entered into this labors, into their labors. Jesus says, I give you your city. I give you your country. I give you your company. Go. I give you your school. Go. What keeps us alive is not the food of the world, the currency of the world, but the will of the Father. What keeps us going and reason for living is not the food of the world, but is the harvest that is already in the fields, another soul. We have to come to a place of great exchange, a place very deep in our hearts, where we realize we're not living for this world anymore. We're not living by the rules of this world anymore, but we live by the rules of our King, Jesus. What He said we do is by what I live. The world Jesus had, He came to a great exchange for loving, not for loving my world anymore, but now I love the kingdom of God more. Not to look at the world the same way anymore. We now look at the world through the heart and the eyes of Jesus. The love, the care, the compassion, love for one another, love your neighbor. Neighbor is not the one of same color. It's the exact the one of another nation, of another color. Those who are in need, those we enable, those we pull up, the poor, the needy. Time to get back, CRC Mbombela, into our assignment to look after those that Jesus said that we have to look after. We have to exchange our little comfort world to the comfort of those who need to be comforted. We need to exchange our little safe world for those who need to be saved in this country, in this city. A shift in the focus from my world, my targets, how my structure, how my ministry, but how do I enable another person to become the best version of themselves? Sometimes in our hearts we have to shift back to our assignment so that we can get back onto the route which Jesus had for us. That land shall be given to the place and to the people that is willing to do what God asked them to do. It's not just for grabs. It is there for those who really need it. Who needs that land? Us four and no more? No. Our city, our community need that land so that people can get saved. So that people can get saved and helped and dressed and being held close and being filled loved in Jesus' name. A shift must happen, CRC Mbombela. A shift in our assignment. Not a shift of winning the lost. That is the assignment. But how do we look after the poor? Not just white people get food parcels. Not just black people get food parcels. No, everyone. Everyone gets what they need. Those who really need it. We should go back into the fields. For the harvest is ready. It's right after that, you don't believe me. Let me show you quickly. In Luke 4, 16 to 30. Right after he said the harvest. Right after that. What about the harvest? What about the harvest? Yeah, it is. In Luke 4, 16 to 13. So he came to Nazareth where he had been brought up. And his custom was, as his custom was, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. We follow Jesus. As his custom on Sundays was to go on Sabbath days to go to church. Are we following Jesus? Yes. Are we busy with the currency of heaven? Or are we still playing around with the currency of our comfort and not the comfort of those who need it? And it was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And he had opened the book. He found the place where it was written. Now Jesus, read this. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The anointing that I have. The church I am in. The position I serve. The Spirit of the Lord. The Holy Spirit is upon me. Everyone says the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Repeat after me. Because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. This is who we are. This is who we are. This is what church is about. This is what CRC Mombela is about. And we better be back into that assignment very quickly. As in from today, tonight we bring our world back. Our youth not to have play nights, but to have pray nights. To have nights where people get saved. To equip those youngsters to go back into the schools. I've seen this week how 11-year-olds walk around in their schools with little bands on them and say, come here, let me tell you. Do you know Jesus? If you die today, where will you go? Heaven or hell? 11-year-old and they can lead people to Christ like a machine. Like a programmed machine. I don't say we are machines. I'm just saying like a boss. You understand what I'm saying? Like a boss, she leads people to Jesus. 11 years old. With a little armband band around her wrist. She says, come here. I give you life. The gift of life is eternal salvation. And she leads people to Christ every day at her school. 11 years old. Why, when we get into our 20s, we think we should stop doing that? In our 30s, it's for other people to do. And then at our 40s and 50s, we're above that. No. There's always, at every age, at every time, a person to be saved in our lives. Who are they? Bring them to church. The love for people. And this is what Jesus said. This is him. Now he says, this is you. He goes on, he closed the book and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all who came to the synagogue were fixed on him. He began to say to them, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is that not Joseph's son? Now they pushed down the church. They pushed down the Bible. They pushed down the pastor. They pushed down the other Christian. They pushed down the other church. They pushed down against them on Facebook, social media, wherever we are. Pushing down another Christian. No love. He said to them, you will surely say this proverb to me. Physician, heal yourself. Whatever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also do here in your country. Now he's talking about him on the cross. A week from here. A week from here, he's going to do this prophecy. Then he said, surely I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you truly, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elijah. And when the heavens were shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a great famine throughout the land, but to none of them was Elijah sent except to Zarephath in the region of Sidon, to a woman who was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian. So all those in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. They rose up and thrust him out of the city. And they led him to the brow of the hill on which their city was built, that they may throw him down over the cliff. Then passing through the midst of them, he went his way. He turned around because he had an assignment, a great exchange for his fame, for his fortune, for his importance, for his mark in life, his position in life, his status in life. He decided a great exchange before he went to the cross. A great exchange of, it's not me that's important anymore. It's not my opinion that's important anymore. It's not my life that's important anymore. I will be the least. I will take the shots of my world. They will reject me. They will fight me. It's not the world that I play for. I play now for heavenly field. I play now for the heavenly crowd. I play now for a heavenly exchange. I exchange my earthly life right here where I am for the heavenly atmosphere, for the heavenly assignment. I change who I am. A great exchange of not to become popular, but then to be persecuted by your friends, your family. You gave your life to Jesus. You're not afraid to say the name Jesus. Take all the information about Jesus now. You take all your thoughts in captivity to be heavenly minded. Your actions to see the world change. Starting with the poor, as if right now. You see, I want to read this. I have to read this because I'm finishing this. Friday I have to preach something totally different, and Sunday. In Matthew 25, 31 to 46, the Bible says, where the Son of Man came in His glory, when the Son of Man came in His glory, and all glory, and all the holy angels with Him, then He will sit on the throne of His glory. This is when Jesus comes back again. This is coming. All the nations will be gathered before Him, and He will separate them from one another, as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And He will set the sheep on His right hand, but the goats on the left. Then the King will say to those on His right hand, come, you blessed of My Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave Me food. I was thirsty, and you gave Me a drink. I was a stranger, and you took Me in. I was naked, and you clothed Me. I was sick, and you visited Me. I was in prison, and you came to Me. Then the righteous will answer Him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? Number one, and the King will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of the least of these, My brethren, you did it to Me. Now He turns to the other people on the other side. Then He will also say to those on the left hand, depart from Me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. There it is. Hell is not prepared for human beings. It's prepared for the devil and angels. Satan wants you there. He wants me there. And he cannot have us because we belong to Jesus. Well, if you've never given your life to Jesus, I do suggest you give it today. No, I plead with you to give your life to Jesus today. You say, how will I know if I will go to heaven? You will know in your heart. If you don't know, if it's this your last day, if you die today, you will know in your heart that you will go to heaven. I want you to pause right there. I wanted to finish this and then I will continue. He says, for I was hungry and you gave Me no food. I was thirsty and you gave Me no drink. I was a stranger and you did not take Me in. Naked and you did not clothe Me. Sick and in prison and you did not visit Me. They also will answer Him saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister to you? Then He will answer to them saying, surely I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to Me. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. It doesn't matter whether you go to heaven or hell. We better look after the poor. He mentioned it twice in one paragraph. To those who go to heaven, He mentioned to them. And those who go to heaven have done these things. Christian, this walk is not for ourselves. It's not about ourselves. It's about our love for one another. Because if we don't love one another, this thing is not possible. But if we love one another, this thing become possible. We will work together, fight together, make sure there's no holes when we serve on a Sunday. Make sure there's no holes when we serve on a Wednesday. Whenever we serve, when we come back here and we disciple everyone. We're all here. We all do our part. We do what we have to do. Tonight we come back and we serve the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. We bring our world to see them saved. We reach out to the poor, to the lost, every home cell, every structure. You have to get back. We have to bring the poor back to church. We have to bring them back to church. We have to bring them back to church. We have to get the transport running again. We have to get out there and give more food parcels than we are currently giving. We have to go out and give more soup than we are currently given. We have to take over our assignment and do what is expected of us. Because Jesus said, when you've did this to the least, we have done it unto Him. CRC Mbombela, let this be a time to reflect, to give, to serve our King the way He served us. To give everything, a great exchange for our comfort, our rest, our everything for those who really need it. God says, refresh them and you will be refreshed yourself. What a great holiday to have is the one where Jesus gives you the rest in Jesus' name. May we be the church that God have sent us to be and do what we have sent to do in the name of Jesus. I want every eye closed, head bowed. al die oogies toe, koppe gebuig. Everyone inside of this building, listen to what I'm asking again. I've asked you 2 minutes ago, I'm asking it again. If this is your last day on this earth, if you die today, I don't ask you, have you fed the poor and anything like that. I don't ask that. I don't ask you, do you go to church or do you read your Bible? I'm not asking that. What I ask is, if you go to heaven, if you die today, will you go to heaven or hell? And you say, I'm not sure. I plead with you to give your life to Jesus. That is why he died. You say, is it as easy as that? You will possibly say to me, yeah, but I still have to change my life. You cannot change your life without Jesus. You first give your life to Jesus, then you change. But it's that decision to follow Jesus. Those who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For God loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son for those who believe in him. We in this time, family. You sit there and you're not saved. You sit there and you're not sure. Please do not leave this building without knowing that you are going to heaven one day. That you are reborn, that you are saved in Jesus' name. If that is you, quickly, as all heads are bowed, eyes are closed, quickly raise your hand so that I can pray with you. Just raise your hand and say, I want to give my life to Jesus this morning. I want to come to Jesus. I want to surrender. I want to give everything back to him. Raise your hand high so that I can see. In Jesus' name. All heads bowed. Thank you. God bless you. All over this place, raise your hands. Raise your hands. Say, I'm coming to you, Jesus. I'm giving you. Here, ek gee vandag oor na jou toe. Dis wat ek jou vra. Gee jou hart vir Christus. Ek vra nie om die kerk te join nie. Ek vra nie om weer te raak nie. Ek vra jou om te doen wat die Bybel sê. Jy moet wedergebore wees. Dis dit. Niks attached to dit nie. Niks. Nothing attached to this. I'm asking you to give your life to Jesus. After that, I will talk to you about what is the way to go from there. That is to read your Bible, to go to church, to pray, to be part of a local church. But that's the first one. That's the first step. Is to give your life to Jesus. The most important step. If you only do that, you will go to heaven. The Bible says you will go to heaven. Then you work out your salvation. And that you need the church for. That is the part of the church to edify Jesus. But now, om geloofsekerheid te hê, is jou saak reg met die Here? Vra ek jou. Is your life right with God? If not, give your life to Jesus. That is you, raise your hand. Say, I want to give my life to Jesus. This morning, I commit to give my life to Jesus. Ek gee my hart vir die Here volgende. In Jesus' name, amen. Second question is, if you did give your life to Jesus, jy het jou hart vir die lewe gee, vir die Here gee, but you wandered away, you walked away, you got angry. I don't know what got you there. Maybe a church, maybe a pastor, maybe a dominee, I'm not sure. What I'm asking you is to turn back to Jesus. Turn back to Jesus. And if that is you, raise your hand quickly all over this place and say, I'm turning back this morning. Ek kom nou terug na die Here toe. The biggest thing that you can do in your life, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you. Can I ask the church to stand to your feet quickly? I'm not going to take long with this, so I'm asking you, if you raise your hand, have not raised your hand, whatever, you have a pushing here on the inside. I want you to be strong today. And you have a pushing, your heart is pounding 5 million times, whatever it is, I'm going to ask you, take whatever you have with you, quickly come to the front that we can pray with you. Give your life to Jesus. Come on, family, your love, your encouragement will bring your world to Jesus. Just come, quickly come. You raise your hand, if not raise your hand, you want to give your life to Jesus. Just come, quickly come. Jesus, you can have my life. Come.
Jesus, you can have it all. Jesus, you can have it all.
Jesus loves you so much. Jesus, you can have it all. Come, family, ask your family, ask your friends. Come. Jesus, you can have my life.
Jesus, you can have it all. Jesus, you can have it all. You love every broken piece of an honest offering. Jesus, you can have it all.
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I want to say, if you're watching online, or you just wherever you are, and you go like, "Hey, I'm going to forward to stop." Okay, it's okay. Just relax. What it's about is to give you, for you to give your life to Jesus. So everyone that stands here at the front, I am very glad you are here, because that is why we have church services. One of the reasons, one of the greatest, the biggest reason. So you are our special guest. Pray with you, to walk this journey with you. Those watching online, if you give your life to Jesus, or even you stand here, you say, "Today I make my life right with God." You can pray this prayer. You put your hand upon your heart. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. But you pray this prayer. It's not my prayer. It is your prayer to Jesus. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Pray after me. Say, "Jesus, I give you my life. I surrender it all. Jesus, thank you that you died on the cross for my sin, for my past and my pain. Jesus, your blood washed me clean. Thank you for saving me. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you rose from the dead and you're alive today. And now alive in me. I am now reborn, saved forever. My name written in the book of life. And nothing can take my name out of that book forever. In Jesus' name, amen." Amen. Come on, let's give God big praise. Hallelujah. So, the Bible says, you prayed that prayer, you believe it in the heart, you say it with your mouth. You are saved. You go, you write this date in a Bible. This is your new birth date, the biggest date in your life. And this date, I gave my life to you. Every year you celebrate this day. Every year you celebrate this day. Amen. It's your birthday. It's a new day. And we want to talk to you about that. So I'm going to ask you all, if you stand here, to go with Chantel. And then you can join us in the service right now. So come on, let's quickly give God a big praise. If you watch online, there's the number on the screens. Contact us. Please contact us. The Bible never says make converts. The Bible says make disciples. So if you've never been discipled, you've never been baptized, you all these kind of things, we're going to ask you to contact us in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. And then we're going to jump right into the baby dedication. Yeah, baby dedication, child dedication. Now, for me, this is one of the greatest. I just want to find out, is there family members that went to the back that should be on the stage? Yes or no? No. If like, you do this. No? Okay. Now you're too afraid to put your hands up because I'm going to call you to the front. No, I won't. We've got four children. I've said a lot at the beginning of the sermon. And parents, this is a promise we make towards God. This is not something to take to be taken lightly. And it's very important. So I'm going to call, there's four babies, children that we're going to dedicate. And you will say, many will say, "Yeah, but why not claim doop?" We just do what the Bible says we have to do. Jesus was baptized when he was 30 years old, and he was dedicated when he was a baby. Dedicated. He was dedicated. So we just follow Jesus. That's it. And you cannot give your life to Jesus if you yourself have not made that decision. You cannot be baptized if you yourself have not made that decision. But parents, what you are doing now is to say, "God, I promise that I will raise this child till the time they come to make up their own mind about following you. But in the meantime, I as a parent am going to do my absolute best." Yes, parents, we need the Holy Spirit. We need the Bible. We need one another in this journey to raise our children, especially in these days. You should be on the boards for your schools. You should be everywhere and fight the good fight as a Christian, to make sure they don't push the wrong things down our children's throats at schools. You have the power, parent. Don't moan and groan about things that are happening in schools, because you have that power, and you should be very involved in your schools as well. One day when these children are bigger, be fully involved at those schools, at the boards, making decisions, because you determine what is being said in that schools. The government cannot overrule that. And we pray that they do not pass legislation so that they didn't. That's the fight we as a church fight. that they cannot change that. So very important. We do everything. We keep them in the house of the Lord, number one. Number two, we fight those fights outside for them, in the schools, in our government. Whenever there's anything we can do to make sure that they have a future, we have to create the platform for these children so that they can run for Jesus. God clearly said to me at the beginning of this year, you are busy creating a platform for a generation that's going to serve me like you could have never served me before. But make sure the platform is stable. And this is who we are. We now, parent, when you don't bring the children to church, you are taking away the platform. When you bring them to church, you are building the platform so that they have good, solid ground to stand on. When they decide to follow Jesus, one day, now you stand in the gap for them. When they get to that day, they stand in front of Jesus and they have a platform to fight from. Me as a person, I was 2.5 years old when I gave my life to Jesus. And I remember every moment. And the second thing that happened after that, my sister was born 6 months later. And I knew as a little child that she should give her life to Jesus. Because when you accept Jesus into your life, you know what is your assignment. The older we get, the more we forget. Please let us not be that generation to forget who we are and what we should do. So, I'm going to ask the parents of these four children to please bring your babies, bring your children. There's a lot of names, so you know who you are, just come. But I want to say the following. We have Kalefa, he's a boy. Names mean brave. Bring your children, are your parents. Then Miane means desire. And we ask you to bring your parents. Van der Merwe nogal, ne? Ja, die Van der Merwe is vat oor. Ja, ek sê julle maar net. Ayan Kosi, the will of God, the boy. And Owen Corsi, the grace of God. I love this. So amazing. So can I ask the parents to please quickly bring your children? Are you here? Is the parents here? Yeah. Please come. Just come and stand on the stage with us and show us your children. And we will take them and make them big. We love the children of this house so much because we see the power of God on the inside of them. The glory of God through them. You can stand in the middle right here. I'll be the usher today. I should have put on the red shirt. Amen. Look, this is the greatest honor for me to celebrate this day with you, with your children. Julle gaan net vanaf ander, soos van der Merwe. Ons is ons net soos like. Amen. What a great time we have. So, what we're going to do as a church. Now, some of you struggle with this thing I saw here at the beginning of the service. So, let me teach you something. The Bible says, everyone says the Bible says, holy men, that means women as well, eh? Say, the Bible says, holy men. Okay, and then you have to do the following. Lifting up. Holy hands. Good, keep it there. Now we pray there for our children. And then parents, you put your hands upon your children. And this you should do every day. Put your hands upon them and believe them. Your hands are just around them. And as we're going to pray for these children, we believe with the parents and we stand in agreement. So here's my question, parents. Are you going to raise these children in the ways of the Lord. Keep them in this presence. Like Jesus says, don't stop the children from coming to me. And if they could, they would have taken your car and drive here every Sunday. But please, they're just too small now for that. Bring them here every opportunity these doors open. Because as they sit here, and I want to tell you this, at the revival week, I saw mothers that have babies, as Pastor had preached and prayed, how the Holy Spirit talk right into that baby's lives already. And as we are dedicating now these children, we say, God, talk into them, work through them. And He does that. He loves our children a lot. So we're going to pray with you now, and then we will just lay our hands upon them. Amen. So, as we pray together, Father, we thank you for every one of these children, that you will bless them, Father, that you will increase their life, that you will protect the parents in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that they will be protected. We thank you they will be blessed, Father, highly favored. The parents, Father, will have all the wisdom and knowledge and blessings from you, Father, to raise these children in your ways. Thank you for their beautiful lives. Thank you, Father. They will have favor wherever they go in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that Satan will have no hold upon them. Whatever he tries will fail, and they will prevail, Father, till the day they come to you and give their lives over to you. But now, Father, we stand in the gap. We thank you for their lives, protection, favor, knowledge, wisdom to be upon their lives. Wherever they go, the schools they go to, they will be protected. And the parents, they will have the ways and the means to raise them in your name, Jesus. Amen. Come on, church, let's give the parents a big shout of praise. Okay, one more time, give them a big hand as they go. You can be seated. Thank you. All about Jesus. Everyone says, it's all about Jesus. I follow Jesus through his word by the power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, make your word come alive in me. Use me to be your hands at your feet in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I know there's a lot of things going to happen this week, but I want you just to watch the screens for the announcements, and then I will release you. But you have to come back tonight, otherwise we sit here till tonight. Now I'm just playing. Watch the screens for the announcements.
And welcome to CRC in this year of overflow.
Yes, Minnie. We would like to encourage you to join one of our home cells. If you're not yet part of a home cell, please leave your name and contact details at the info desk so that we can help you find a home cell near you. Home cell is a family you cannot afford to miss.
Family, we also stand together and we pray here every Wednesday morning at 5:30. Join us, your life will never be the same again. The Easter weekend is the most important weekend on the Christian calendar. Join us as we celebrate what Jesus Christ did for you and for me. We will be having a Good Friday service at 9 a.m. and also a CRC Easter production service on Sunday, 6 p.m. This is a weekend you do not want to miss out on.
Every time you give to the poor, you make a loan to the Lord. Don't worry, you'll be repaid in full for all the good you've done. While people are hurting, we cannot look the other way. Jesus never called us just to sit and soak, but he has sent us just as his Father sent him. The Spirit of the Lord is upon us because he has anointed us to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent us to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Proverbs 11 verse 25 says, "The one who blesses others is abundantly blessed. Those who help others are helped." Let's take a look at the last few years and the impact we've made as a church in our communities. From 2019 to 2024, we've given out school bags, clothes, cups of soup, and many, many more things. Over 67,620 food parcels have been distributed to our members in need, as well as during crisis events like the KZN flooding disaster in 2023, upholding our ongoing mission to alleviate poverty and restore dignity to those facing hardship. 43,687 back-to-school bags were packed to the brim, full of stationery. Over 120,000 items of gently worn clothes have been handed out in our communities, just to name a few. We want to say thank you to every CRC member who continually partners with us to uplift and meet the needs of our communities. Thank you for being the hands and feet of Jesus.
It is now time to bring our tithes and offerings into the house of the Lord. As the ushers prepare to take up our tithes and offerings, we kindly ask that you remain seated during this time.
Yes, and family, please note that for your security, the doors of the church will remain closed until the end of the service. We'll now be blessed with an amazing item. God bless.